Welcome to the Dream Life is Real Life podcast with your host, Hanna Hermanson, bringing you real life stories of people who realized their dreams to educate and inspire you to create your legacy of abundance now.
Welcome back, everyone. Today, I'm hanging out with Erin McGuire. And Erin is a lover of world travel, nature, wellness, and all aspects of living simply. She started her entrepreneurial journey teaching Kundalini and Hatha yoga. She's taught extensively all over the world for almost a decade. She transitioned into coaching and energy work after working extensively with her coach on mindset and beliefs for several years. Her passion is assisting young girls and women to get out of feeling not good enough, not living their passion, and not feeling empowered into raising into their greatness. She works with clients from age 8 to 60. That's amazing. Her latest program, Alchemy, is a 3-month program that goes deeply into shifting old beliefs and energy that are keeping you stuck and allowing you to have more confidence, feel empowered, and truly learn to love yourself and live a life that you love. She also has a 9-month Alchemy Coach training program to teach you how to do the deep work she does with people. Her next project is her first book, intended to come out in 2019, as well as an Alchemy program for young girls and teens. Welcome, you amazing spirit.
Thank you, Hanna.
Yeah, so I have to give listeners a little bit of backstory in that I first met Erin in real life. I'm always promoting, like, actually, you know, meeting people in real life these days at my yoga teacher training. And I've since been so inspired by the work that you do. And just like your introduction said, really shifting those stuck patterns and limiting beliefs that are holding us back from our greatness. So excited to share your message and just you in general with more people today. So thank you.
Yeah, of course. I'm happy to be here.
Yeah. So I want to learn a little bit more about your journey and going from teaching yoga and having your own personal exploration, doing your own work, to now becoming a coach. So was there like a specific moment when you decided I'm going to take my work to the next level and share this, or was it a longer process?
I think it was probably a longer process. Just giving a little bit of my backstory, had a pretty rough childhood, a lot of addiction in my family, and grew up with some pretty painful memories. And so, I think yoga, like when I found yoga for my practice, that was kind of my release, because I had a lot of anxiety from growing up in such a way. And then, you know, I just kind of stumbled into becoming a teacher. I was kind of more forced into it. I never thought that I could do that. And really found my passion in teaching. But I do remember a specific moment when I was driving in Los Angeles, because I saw private clients all over LA. And, you know, that can be, it can take an hour or longer to get to somebody. And so yeah. I just remember thinking, like, I'm driving and I'm doing all this work to work out somebody's body, but I'm more interested in working out their mind. And so there was kind of that specific moment. But prior to that, I had been doing that with my coach and mentor for about 3 years. And I was apprenticing with her to kind of learn what she did. But again, I never thought that I would go out and do that. I just saw how much it was changing my life, that at one point I'm like, okay, I have to share this with other people, because if it did this for me, I would feel bad not sharing that with somebody else.
Yeah. Yeah. Like Marie Forleo says, the world needs that special gift that you have, and to be given the gift of having a mentor helping you work out your mind and to just hold on to those tools probably wouldn't be as rewarding as, like you said, sharing it widely. Yeah. So I can totally relate also to that feeling of starting out in a yoga practice for the physical benefits or the physical exercise, and then quickly or eventually realizing that the mind-body-spirit connection is strong. So Do you still integrate yoga in a physical practice into the coaching that you do? Or how are you now combining the mental and physical exercises?
That's a good question. With my coaching clients, I'm not coaching them through physical practice as well. It's more mental and emotional and life coaching type things that I'm working on them with. But I do suggest, you know, doing yoga, but where, or their own practice, I should say. But where I see yoga coming into play is I do assign people different sorts of breath work because I think the breath is so important. In yoga, that's our prana. It's our life force. And we're only using such a small fraction of our actual life force every day. So there's some actually really powerful breathwork sequences that I give people that can, you know, help with depression and anxiety and like clear your mind and just generate more power within your body. So that's where I see it coming into play. And then also the philosophy of yoga. I've always been really into like the Yoga Sutras and the deep, deep philosophy of yoga. I think that very much comes into play with clients because there's a lot there.
Yeah, definitely. Well, I asked that question a little bit selfishly because, you know, obviously you were at my yoga teacher training that's my background. And yet now that I'm moving into more of the coaching and working with entrepreneurs, goal setting, I do find that my yoga comes into what I do, but it's not explicit. And I think that's maybe what you're saying as well, in that you have a background in yoga, it's more of a lifestyle than a routine or a habit. Would you agree?
Right, exactly. Yeah, it's just, it is who I am. Like, it can't not come out of me in some way, but I'm not necessarily telling people to do 20 sun salutations every day, although that's not a bad idea. It's not a bad thing to tell somebody to do.
Yeah, well, I am a bit curious if you could share with us what you are telling people and maybe share with us one of those breath exercises that will bring more prana to listeners.
Yeah, I think that's a great idea. Really, my work is involved because I had such a rough childhood. You know, I really am big on, we use like our trauma can become like in yoga terms, our dharma, which means our purpose. Mm-hmm. So our trauma can become our purpose when we use it to help others. And that's really what I'm all about, is taking whatever pain or suffering that you've been through in your life and turning it around and helping others with it. And so the biggest thing that my teacher worked on me with, using the modality of theta healing, which is more of the energy-based work and clearing beliefs in the subconscious mind, I really help people learn about their brain. You know, from a scientific standpoint, your brain is designed to protect you because we're wired to be in fear. Mm. We're wired to, you know, always be looking out for the danger around us. That's just how our brains work. And so whenever we're about to go do something creative or a big project, the brain is going to bring up a lot of resistance and fear-based thoughts because that's what it's trained to do. It's a different, you're doing something different. Our brains like to be on autopilot. Mm. And so I think the biggest thing I like to share with people is to teach them about their brain and their subconscious mind, which is pretty new for a lot of people. They don't really think about themselves in that way. We just are like, oh my gosh, I'm afraid to go do this thing, or I'm really stuck in this situation, but we don't understand why we got there. And so so that's a big part of it. And then also going back and healing some of the wounds of childhood. So I don't like to spend a lot of time there. I like to say that healing can actually be fun, which sounds pretty crazy given that I do pretty deep transformational work. But I like to bring it as much lightness to it and laughter as I can. But yeah, so I go back and I help my clients to reparent the inner child that lives within them. Mm-hmm. And we do this through different meditations, different energy clearings that I do with them. And another piece that's a big aspect of what I do is what I call emotional empowerment. And it's this whole exercise that I take somebody through. Often we have to go through it several times with different emotions, but it's with the main negative emotion that you struggle with, whether it's self-doubt or feeling not good enough. That's a big one for a lot of women that I work with. And we go back because it's like whatever's going on in your life right now that you don't like, there's a reason for that. Mm-hmm. Something happened along the way and somebody programmed your computer, your brain, in an unwanted way, whether it was a teacher, a parent, a sibling, it doesn't matter who it was. Could have happened when you were
society.
Society, exactly. Yeah, somebody programmed the computer in the wrong way. And so what I'm really doing is clearing and bringing you back to that clean slate, kind of like when you were born. It's almost like a rebirthing. Like, you're back to that clean slate before all those faulty programs got installed.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Okay. So yes, what we are doing is much more than a 60-minute flow or a simple breath exercise to do in traffic. You're really peeling back all of the layers and reprogramming our subconscious mind, because we know that that's what creates our reality and our fear and all these other frustrations or negative emotions, like you said.
Exactly.
So can you share like a success story, or like, I'm super curious about, you know, where people come to you at and what are some of these transformations that you're seeing in this subconscious work?
Yeah. I mean, there's been so many, but, one of my earliest clients back, like when I first started doing this work in LA many years ago, I mean, she credits me to her losing 70 pounds. When I met her, she didn't have a boyfriend. She hadn't been in a relationship in 10 years. She was extremely overweight. You just to look at her, like she just had dark circles under her eyes. And once we peeled back some of the layers, because right away I asked, you know, what was your relationship like with your parents and all this kind of stuff? And her parents, you know, had been on her about being skinny. Well, ding, 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 ding. You know, yeah. This is why we're having issues with weight, you know, because weight's a protective, we put on weight to protect ourselves subconsciously. Mm-hmm. We don't even realize we're doing that. So she, after working, and she worked with me for a good year, there was a lot to peel back, you know? So, mm-hmm. She credits me to getting in a relationship. She's still in that relationship now. She lost 70 pounds. She looks like a different person.
Mm. I'm sure, like you said, there's so many things that are connected. Yes. But just to even have that sort of realization that I'm gaining weight as a protector, and it is okay to go inward and unpack this and release not only weight, but it sounds like a lot of, you know, history and limiting beliefs, I'm sure, were wrapped up in there. So,
yeah, amazing. So many.
And so the other piece that I actually didn't know about that I wanted to ask you about is the work you're doing with young people, because I'm sure you're not trying to run yourself out of a job working with people to reprogram their childhood, but tell us about that aspect of your work. And are you getting to young people before they're being, you know, quote unquote, programmed the wrong way?
Such a good question. That's been a rather new thing since I've moved back to Iowa, where I'm from. I don't know even how it started, to be honest. I'm sitting here trying to think, like, how did this ever start? But basically, I started seeing kid clients. I think my youngest was 6, and she was having anxiety. So I see a lot of women, adults as well, with anxiety. And I will say a success story in that one woman came to me, she was having daily panic attacks. And in one session, the panic attacks went away because we got to the root cause of where they were coming from. Mm. So there's a lot of things like that that go on. But even kids nowadays are experiencing a lot of anxiety. Mm-hmm. With school, this particular young girl, it was due to a storm that had caused her some fear. But I see a lot of little girls around the age of 8 and 9, not a lot, but a handful, that are struggling in school with like bullying and not feeling secure and feeling like they have to change. This one little girl was so cute. She's like, I can't wear my rainbow mermaid shirt because I feel like I'm going to get made fun of. And it just broke my heart. Mm. So it's really helping young girls not get to the place where they feel not good enough, because that's what I see with every woman I work with. On some level, every woman, whether we've worked through it or not, basically every human on the planet suffers from a feeling of not good enough. It's one of our deepest fears. Tony Robbins actually said that, that a feeling of not good enough or not being loved, those are the two human fears that we all have. So on some level, we're working out of that in some way or another. And so I really see a lot of adults that are people pleasers, perfectionists. We're doing all these things in order to make the people around us like us so that we can prove that we're good enough. Mm-hmm. And I started to think, you know, why not start working with these girls when they're younger and empower them, make them feel really good about who they are so that they can hopefully avoid some of the things I had to go through and a lot of the clients that I see go through.
Yeah, I think that's so beautiful. And a lot of entrepreneurs and educators listening to this podcast, I'm sure, appreciate that feeling of solving the problems that you had to work through. And I so often hear people who just turn around and help other people through what they've already been through, and to go back generationally and start to instill the right programming, I think is really inspiring. And you're so right. More girls and women need to be reminded that they are so good enough, and wear your rainbow mermaid shirt until you're 40, please. Yeah.
I know. I was just like, no, you got to get that out and wear that.
Because if you won't, I will.
That's right.
Yeah. Yeah. So did you ever have a sort of full-time job, or where did you kind of, when did you get started on charting your own path and being your own boss this way?
Yeah, I definitely had several full-time jobs. Out of college, I was a marketing director at a retirement home. When I moved to which was a great job. I really liked that. When I moved to Los Angeles, I moved there to be an actor. And because it was just a dream that I always had. And I got to dabble in it a little bit. But I had to get a job to pay the bills. And so I was working at a very high-end restaurant in Beverly Hills. And I call it the dark night of the soul, because you made a lot of money, but it was a just very soul-sucking job because of the clientele and that sort of thing. But, and it was there that I found, when I was working there, is when I found yoga, because it was very intense time in my life of driving around to different casting calls, and then going to the restaurant every night. It was just a lot of chaos in my life. And so I found yoga, and that helped me a lot. But it was in, after a series of events, which will all be in the book, not that I don't want to share them.
What a cool thing to be able to say. After a series of events, which is in my book.
Which is in the book. Yeah, I don't mean to not share it, but it's kind of heavy, and this is probably not the place to share that kind of stuff. But after a series of events, I got the intuition. I actually had a dream. So I'm a pretty intuitive person. And I had this dream where it was like my boss at that restaurant was shooting me. And he's like, will you just sit up? I have to shoot you 22 times. Mm. And I was like taking all the bullets. And I woke up and I'm like, I'm going to put in my notice today. Like, that is my soul telling me I'm dying here.
Wow.
And it was a really powerful moment. And it was not a good time to quit financially, but I knew if I stayed one more day, it just would be going against my truth. And so I did that and took some time. And then I would say I went traveling around the world in 2011, which just was a traveling gypsy, lived in Asia and taught yoga around Asia and whatnot. And then it was probably like in 2012 that I really got serious about starting my business. And I've been going ever since.
Wow. Yeah, that's a really powerful story. And I think that whether or not we have those really stark, memorable dreams, or we just get those feelings or those nudges, or we keep having these recurring thoughts, like, it's okay to lean into your intuition. And like Erin's saying, it may not be the most convenient time or the most logical decision. But there's so much that we really ought to be listening to that isn't just our mom or society or our boss, yes. Right?
Yes.
Wow. Okay. Incredible. And now I'm super excited for your book.
Thank you.
Yeah, I know that you, or the little bit I know about your story is that you are a total warrior and someone that has really walked through this work that you're now sharing. So I feel good things coming. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I want to move into the segment of the show that I like to call Pop Quiz.
Oh, goodness.
you have a background in acting, so you can even just make it up if you want to, but I think you'll be fine. Just three last questions for you.
Okay.
All right. So the first one is, what is something that listeners can do today, an exercise, movement, anything to get them closer to their highest self or their dream life?
Oh, I love that. Well, why don't I go back? Because you asked for breath work in the beginning. So yeah. Why don't I reflect it with a breath work sequence? Can it be three things that are really quick?
Yes, please.
Okay. So I recently taught a workshop at a yoga festival here in the Midwest, and I called it Accessing Your Inner Power. And to me, the three biggest things we can do that are all three yoga-based to access our inner power is, number one, meditate in some way, which, Hannah, I know you're great about telling your clients about, so that's great. Whatever way you meditate is fine. There's not one better way than another, but like at least 3 minutes of like just sitting still and listening to your breath or whatever you like to do. The second thing is a breath work. So in Kundalini yoga, we do breath of fire a lot. It's a little hard to teach over the phone, but you basically sit up nice and tall. Google it if you need to. I do have a YouTube video of it that you can find. But you sit up nice and tall, and you basically want to inhale and exhale through your nose. And on the exhale, you pull the belly button to the spine very powerfully. Mm-hmm. So you kind of really pull... Or it's called Kapalabhati in Hatha yoga. We just shorten it and call it breath of fire. But a really powerful breath sequence is, to me, extremely important. And that can, again, 3 minutes. Doesn't need to take that long. Minute and a half is really all you need. And then the last thing is what we call, and I can't believe I'm going to say this, pulling the Mula Bandha. So it's, let's just call it pulling your bandhas. And so I have a whole video on that as well, so I don't have to discuss this over a podcast. But you basically want to pull up, let's call it your pelvic floor. You want to inhale, pull up your pelvic floor. And what I do is I imagine a golden light from the base of my spine. It goes up through my entire spine, all of my chakras, and out through the crown of my head. And when you're doing that, you're cleansing your energetic body, your physical body. And for those of you that are listening, I know that a lot of people are entrepreneurs.
It's hard to spell too. I don't know why we chose that title. I got you though. Yeah. Entrepreneurs.
Thank you for understanding there. for those of us that are working with, you know, with people, you know, we need to keep our channels very clear. And so those three things right there are, to me, the top things you can be doing for yourself to really, keep yourself in a higher vibe space and not maybe take on so much of other people's energy all the time.
So powerful. And I will definitely encourage folks to find you on YouTube, because you're right. It's hard to just describe these exercises, but if you, you know, check out the YouTube video, learn it, and spend 3 minutes of your day taking, you know, moving yourself through these exercises, you will be, way higher vibe, which isn't that a good thing?
Yes. It's so, like putting yourself, it's like a supercharger, you know, it's like, why run on half battery when we have a full battery to run on?
Yes. Good stuff. So the second question is a little bit related, but what I like to ask guests is, what is a tangible resource that you would encourage people to get their hands on? Whether that's like a book that changed your life or another tangible resource. My people are big readers, but also podcast listeners. And do you have anything that you'd recommend besides the breathwork and your YouTube video?
And my book. No, just kidding.
It's right.
I'm trying to think of a book that I really, there's so many books. One's not popping into my head. So I would say Abraham Hicks. You can listen to them on YouTube. That's going to put you in a high vibe space. Just, regardless of your beliefs or whatever, I tell people leave whatever doesn't resonate. If it resonates with you, then take what you can from it. Because there's just so much there. And there's literally like hours upon hours upon hours of listening material. If you are just in a, lower vibe, crappy kind of headspace, that will shift you very quickly.
Yeah, really great. Abraham Hicks, I'm surprised no other guest has mentioned him, but he's definitely a go-to. He's really good to do like curl your hair to, or clean the bathroom. I find myself like when I find those tasks where I'm just like, oh, this is going to be tedious, I will multitask with him. So
I love that. Yeah. The book that popped into my head is The Power of Imagination by Novell. He's an old timer, like from the 1920s or 30s, like a thought leader. And his stuff is really intense, but extremely powerful.
Cool. I'll have to check that one out. That's not one I've heard of. So thank you.
Yes.
The last question, you're doing great, is how can people stay connected with you and learn more about what you do?
Yeah. So my website is purelightwellness.com. And it's LIGHT, purelightwellness.com. And that's probably the easiest way. I'm on Facebook as Pure Light Wellness and Instagram. And, my YouTube channel is under Erin McGuire or Pure Light Wellness. If you put those two together, you'll find it. So yeah, Pure Light Wellness is the place to go to learn more.
Perfect. Yeah, I highly encourage you all. You know, Erin mentioned she has YouTube resources and lots of ways to increase your vibe, just probably by following her on Instagram, but also feeling free to continue this conversation with her because she really is pure and light and just a wealth of knowledge and goodness. So thank you so much for sharing some of your insight and your energy today. And listeners, we will be back next week with another inspiring leader that will help make your dream life your real life.
You've been learning how to make your dream life your real life with Hanna Hermanson. To get the resources mentioned on today's show and to listen to past episodes, visit www.dreamlifeisreallife.com.